Hi, I'm Edgar Martins. I'm a Portuguese artist living between the UK and Portugal, and I'm the author of the exhibition here at the Herbert Art Gallery and Museum. The project on show here at the Herbert Art Gallery and Museum is a project titled What Photography and Incarceration Have in Common with an Empty Vase. It's a multifaceted, fragmentary body of work developed over a period of 3 years with growing projects in inmates in the Midlands, as well as their families, in a myriad of other organizations and individuals, such as charities, colleges, universities, youth centers, some of which associated with specific prisons, some not. I should say from the outset that although I visit inmates and their families regularly in prison, in their cells, during family days, during legal visits, I decided from the outset not to photograph inside the prison walls. So the project uses the social context of incarceration to really think about the philosophical concept of absence. In other words, how do we deal with the absence of a loved one brought on by enforced separation? From an ontological perspective, I was interested in questions like, how do we represent a subject that eludes visualization, that is absent or hidden from view? In other words, you know, how do you talk about incarceration without photographing inside the prison walls? Photography for so long has been defined in terms of the relationship it has with the subject it purports to represent. So what does it mean for photography if it doesn't identify with its subject, but its absence? Can absence be a form of activation? Moreover, in an era of fake news, how can we best acknowledge the fictional and imaginative dimension of our relation to photographs? So the more you get to know the work, the more you become aware of this constant tension between revelation and concealment, revelation and obfuscation. So by giving a voice to inmates and their families in addressing prison as a set of social relations rather than a mere physical space, the work tries to rethink and counter the sort of narrative that is normally associated with incarceration, in which it usually revolves around themes of drugs, violence, criminality, race. Of course, there are images within the show that seemingly depict elements of violence, but all is not what it seems. So in addition to photographing inmates and their families, I also photographed people enacting their stories. And I employed this methodology so that the viewer is never really aware or doesn't always know who he's looking at, he or she's looking at in the photographs. And this was a way for me to be able to disrupt the power relations and the kind of voyeurism inherent in the consumption of this type of imagery. So needless to say, I went to great lengths to avoid images whose sole purpose, in my opinion, only serves to uphold the sort of dominant perceptions of or the kind of dominant ideology about crime and punishment. So I see these images as an act of resistance. They are a counterpoint to the role that documentary photography normally plays in these ethically charged environments. They seek the hidden narratives rather than the glaring truths. Many images talk of the situation of agency, of the difficulty of testifying at any precise moment in history, that images of the so-called other, or violence, and we can extend this to war, conflict, death, they raise a disconcerting paradox. They, I suppose, intensify a traumatic awareness of the subject, but at the same time, they have a pacifying effect, sort of alleviating the extent of the trauma. But despite this, I've come to believe that there is a place for photography in these ethically charged environments. The point at issue is, what role should it play and how should it operate? How can photographs reveal and resist at the same time? And I think it's for this reason that I no longer call these artworks photographs, but lipographs. So lipographs is a term that I've coined and which is obviously inspired in the Ulipo movement's lipogram. A lipogram used to be a literary device where certain constraints are applied to written language and where, for example, a sentence would be constructed without a specific letter or vowel. Georges Perec, the famous spearhead of this movement, he famously wrote an entire novel without the letter E. A few years later, he wrote another novel only using the vowel E. So a lipogram, or lipograph, I should say, is a visual representational device which omits its referential subject. In other words, how do we talk about prison without physically photographing inside the prison walls? A lipograph is the proverbial impossible document. It demands a conceptual reorientation from the viewer. In other words, the renunciation of the viewer's automatic predisposition for certainty. One of the things that becomes immediately apparent when you visit the show is that there are a lot of images of animals. Now, people tend to think of these as metaphors for psychological states. And of course, that's a valid observation. However, I don't really see them this way. One of my aims throughout this project was to explore this notion of photography as catachresis. Catachresis is a term, or photography as catachresis is a concept originally proposed by the art historian Richard Schiff in the 1960s. Although in that case, it was related to the concept of phototropism. I'm interested primarily just in catachresis as a trope. So let me give you an example of a catachresis, the arm of a chair or the leg of a table. So these terms are catachrestic because they use symbols related to human physiology in order to describe something where there is no other way to say it. So catachresis is a trope that registers language's ability to communicate something when under pressure, but also its own inadequacy. And that is how I feel about photography. It's an inadequate medium to operate within these highly ethical, charged environments. On one of my many visits to the prison, I came across an inmate with the darkest and dingiest cell I'd come across in my time there. And this inmate had asked had been asking for 2 years to be moved to a different cell, but because it was very disruptive, the prison authorities were very reluctant to do this. So I suppose reluctant that he would spend the rest of his 10-year sentence in this dark and dingy cell, he took matters into his own hand. So he decided to ask his family to smuggle into the family days a blue felt tip pen. And this was so that he could actually paint his cell window a blue color, so the kind of sky blue that he no longer saw. And of course, the image behind the blue panel, which is applied on glass using a serigraphy process, is a photograph of the Everglades, which is where he last vacationed with his family before being incarcerated. This work is titled No Man is an Island. One day, I was invited in my hometown by one of the families I was working with to attend a psychoanalytic session being offered to one of their children. This clinic was part of a program launched by a local mental health charity that supported the relatives of prisoners struggling with the incarceration of their partners. So this artwork, which is titled No Man is an Island, is based on the observations I made from one of the psychoanalysis sessions I attended. The bird represents the father of the child in her dreams. The girl eating the bird represents the daughter appropriating the memory of her father. The mouth in psychoanalytic literature, of course, is often seen as an eye. So the mouth as an eye references the daughter constructing an identity for her father in his absence. In the 1960s, the Italian conceptual artist Piero Manzoni, he produced a piece called Artist's Breath. It comprised only of his breath in a balloon, which he then affixed to a plank of wood. Today, the balloon is deflated, although the piece continues to be sold in auctions. The work that you see behind me is titled Prisoner's Breath. I was often the conduit between the inmates and their families. So what I decided to do was actually get the inmates to blow their air into a balloon and then give the balloons to the families themselves. So paradoxically, there's something interesting about the kind of the reversal journey of these balloons. In most cases, they're used to smuggle things into prison. In this case, I was smuggling something out of prison, which of course was part of the inmate himself. During my many visits to the prison, I developed a relationship with several inmates, one in particular who actually ended up writing an entire series of diaries for this project. But one of the interesting things is that they told me the stories of other inmates that had been through the prison. Of course, the prison that I worked with, they're remand prison, but for some reason there were inmates doing very long sentences there. And they told me about the story of an inmate, which obviously preceded my time and their time. And this individual used to spend a long time in solitary confinement because, again, he was very disruptive. And he found this ingenious way to communicate with others, where he would get prison guards, security staff, and so on, to give him certain stationery, pencils, pens, and so on. And then he would carefully erase the messages or the brand names in the station, whether it be pens or pencils, and stencil or paint on his own messages. They would usually just be one-word messages. And this is how he communicated with others for a very long time, because, of course, then he would pass the pencil or the pen to the unknowing security guard and would say, look, can you give this to this person or that person? And he was only discovered, during his trial when someone attempted to do the same thing to him, sort of give him an actual pencil with a message on it saying, plead guilty. And from that moment on, of course, they ended up confiscating all of this material from him. But still, I like this idea of messages in stationery, or short messages in stationery, because to me they talk of this concept of a destinerence. A destinerence is a term that was originally proposed by the French philosopher Derrida, and it combines notions of errancy and destiny. And his concept or his idea was that every letter, anything that's written, a postcard, every missive, creates destinerences because it continues to circulate and signify long after death. And I feel the same way about photographs or language, writing in general, that they create their own destinerences. So these photographs create their own destinerences.